So I'm Kyle Chadburn. I use the pronouns he, him, his. This is my 10th year as an educator. I'm technically the social studies teacher in the middle school here. And
I'm Andrea Grattan. I use she, her, hers pronouns. This is my 9th year as an educator. And I was hired to teach English language arts, but Kyle and I have combined forces and we now co-teach a course that we call humanities, which is a combination of both of our subject areas.
We are doing that program at Orleans Elementary School in Orleans, Vermont, which technically is a village in the town of Barton, way up in the Northeast Kingdom. If you're not familiar with us, you can see the little star on the map there. We're stone's throw from Canada. And we are a small rural K-8 school. We have some issues with poverty in our community. So just to give you a little background, demographics of students and families. Not directly as a result of that, but certainly contributing to that, we've had some challenges with engaging students in their education and trying to keep them engaged throughout the course of their K-8 education and on to high school. So part of what we're gonna be talking about today is sort of how do we use these tools that we're gonna be discussing to help with that engagement and helping struggling learners.
And just to clarify a little bit about our course, because our school is so small, we average about 10 to 15 kids in a grade. In order for Kyle and I to co-teach, the way that we made that work was that we would have to combine two classes. And so we have one section, which is a fifth and sixth grade combined humanities class. And then we have another section, which is a seventh and eighth grade combined humanities class.
We have a few different sections built into our day. One of the benefits of being able to co-teach is that we get a long chunk of time with each of our classes. Right now we have a little over 2 hours a day, about 2 hours a day with each group. And so we've tried to break that down so that we can kind of move through a series of activities, make sure that we're not spending too much time on any one thing. So we have the different components that you see there, and I won't read them to you. But one of the ones that we're going to be definitely focusing on today is independent workshop time, which is a chunk of time that's designed specifically to allow students to direct their own learning. And that's about 25 minutes per day. But we also try to use some of these other types of playlists that we'll be discussing a little later to add some student-directed learning into the other components of our day. So even though independent workshop is defined as that is always going to be student-directed, it's always going to be an opportunity for them to make choices about how they're learning and kind of pace themselves. We also want to make sure that we achieve kind of a balance between teacher-directed, student-directed learning so that that way it's happening throughout the course of our class period.
We started the year 5 days a week in person, and we decided to go with a block schedule to do that. And so on that slide with the schedule, we ended up doing all of that every day because we would have students for an entire day for humanities. We would have 7, 8 for an entire day while the fifth and sixth graders were at math and science. And then the next day we would flip and have 5 fifth and sixth grade for the entire day. So we did all of those activities in one day. And then we switched to hybrid where we saw students every other day and we kept the same chunks. We just decided which ones stay in school and which ones are happening at home. So regardless of the COVID situation, all of those are part of our humanities day.
We've kind of found a way to make it so that whether we're fully in person or hybrid, or even if we were to go fully remote, which we have not had to do, thankfully, that we would still be able to keep those same components in place and be able to facilitate learning the same way so that there's consistency for the kids.
And so we have these different chunks of our days where it's more teacher directed, more student directed, small groups, large groups, all different types of learning happening throughout the day. And we try to fit playlists in different parts of the day, as Kyle was saying. And so before we move on, we just wanted to clarify the word playlist because traditionally a playlist is here's kind of like the unit overview. Here's what I need you to do in this order. Here are the steps you're going to take. Here are the tools you're going to use. Work your way down. And there's a link in there if you want to learn more about that traditional style of playlist and where that came from and what that looks like. We tend not to use that as much. We use the word playlist very broadly to really cover anything that allows students choice in what they learn or how they learn, or gives them the opportunity to work at their own pace without a defined deadline of you can work at your own pace, but you better be done by this day. That's not how that works for us. So anything that meets the criteria listed in those bullets is what we would consider a playlist. And so we're gonna show you a lot of different options of what that looks like today. Might be the traditional playlist, could be what people generally refer to as choice boards or choice menus, could also be hyperdocs. And so we're gonna have the option for you to explore some of the resources that we've used and created, and talk to you about the ones that you're most interested in learning more about.
And that's the goal for all of these different tools.
Just a reminder that in general, these playlists are used during one of our two workshop times. The workshops are daily and they're about 25 minutes a piece. One is a guided workshop that is small group instruction with one of us, and the independent workshop is something that's designed really for students to be able to take control of their learning and move ahead at their own pace, and kind of guide themselves and make choices along the way. So that's how the workshop structure is set up. For fifth and sixth grade, we tried to focus on some really kind of simple, straightforward information. And so we start with geography. And that seems like it's been fairly successful for fifth and sixth graders because it's such a concrete thing. And so we're gonna take a look at one of those playlists just so you can kind of get a feel for what they look like, but they are all kind of structured the same way.
Yeah, so we have a series of playlists that we designed to support students as they work through different topics of geography. It starts with continents and oceans, moves to US states, then Canadian provinces, and then countries of the world. We're going to look at the US states playlist together. So all of the geography playlists are structured the exact same way. They all look the same. It's just different information in each one. So students would open up this slideshow. They would put it in present mode. And then they all start with an instructional video to remind students how to use the playlist. And then when they're ready, they always hit the red button to the red arrow to move on. So once they have the instructional video, then it always starts with the learning targets of what students should know by the time they have completed this playlist or what they're going to need to demonstrate mastery of on their badge test at the end, which is an assessment they can take whenever they'd like. So we always start with a pre-assessment just to get a sense of what students already know, where they're at with their skills. So there's some directions on the side and then they just click the image and that's gonna take them to a website called Lizard Point, which is where they take their assessment. And then when they're done with that, again, they'll hit the red arrow and it will ask them how they did. And each of these circles is going to link to a different part of the playlist so that students can get the targeted support that they need. So if students are just getting started, they scored 70% or below on the assessment, then they would click on the orange circle and that would take them to a very structured list of tasks that they're going to need to complete in this order to really build up those basic skills. So it tells them here are the four different tasks you're going to need to complete. They'll hit the red arrow and they'll work their way through those tasks. So the first one is a video, again, directions on the left, activity on the right. Once they've done that, they'll move on to the second one. This is a game that they can play. And the first time they play it with the lines so that they can see the borders of the states. So there's an instructional video on the left. They click on the image on the right, it'll take them to the game. Practice activity three is another game. That's a little bit more complex. So again, directions, click on the image, it'll take them to that activity. And then activity four is the game they played previously, but you'll notice that the boundary lines between the states are gone. And so now they're going to need to try to demonstrate their understanding of the location of each of the states without those lines. Once they've gone through all of those, then they're going to do a check-in assessment, see where they're at now. So it's the same assessment they took before. They'll click on that image, and again, it'll ask them how they did. So if they're still scoring 70% or below, they'll go back through those activities again and spend some more time practicing with that. If they have made progress and they seem to have a lot of the information down, but they're still not quite there yet at mastery, then they would move on to I'm making progress. So they'd click on this green circle. And at this point, it gives them the choice of how do you want to move forward with your learning. So they could click on the pink sticky note and go back to the same practice activities that I showed you before. And for some people, that's where they start because they're scoring above 70% on their pre-assessment. And for others, it's just an opportunity to go back and continue with those activities that are familiar and comfortable for them and maybe are helping them move forward. If they don't want to do that, they also have the option to go to a choice board. And at this point, the activities are no longer structured in a particular order. It just gives them a variety of ways that they could practice this skill and work toward mastery. So they can do any of the digital activities up top, any of the non-digital activities, they can do them in any order. They can just focus on one. If there's one that really works for them, they could do all of them. That's really where the choice comes in. And then when they feel like they're ready, they'll take their badge test assessment. Again, directions on the left, click on the image to access the assessment. And again, it'll ask them, how did you do? So again, they'll click on the circle that's right for them. And if they get, if they score 90% or above, we consider that mastery. So they click on the blue skill, it'll congratulate them, tell them they can put their badge in their portfolio. We have digital badges that students use. And then it tells them, which playlist to move on to. And so the next one is Canadian Provinces and Territories. It looks exactly the same, just with different information and tasks in it. So that's how we run our 5-6 playlists. There's some feedback from students down below about those. And then Kyle will talk to you about our 7-8 workshop playlist, because those look a little bit different.
So with 7th and 8th grade, we're dealing with a couple of changes. One is the fact that the content is a little bit more complex. So with 5th and 6th grade, it was very concrete information of geography. This place is located on a map in this area, and I can just identify those things and name them. For 7th and 8th grade, we're looking at more conceptual information that they're learning about. And so we start the year learning about government. And so the playlists that they're using are focused around learning what's the purpose of government, what are the different types of governments that exist in the world, and then it starts to zero in on American government. We look at how our government in the United States is structured with the branches and political parties and elections, and then how all that works. So the content is different than with 5-6. The other thing that's different is that there's a little less differentiation that happens along the way. It's kind of a pathway through the same activities no matter what. And then the differentiation part comes with just being able to go back and revisit and revisit and revisit as needed, because this is a self-paced activity, just like the 5th and 6th graders have. They're able to work and move forward at their own pace and make progress at a pace that works best for them. And the nice thing about this workshop model is that it allows us to be able to conference with students that are maybe struggling a little bit and try to help move them forward, while other kids are free to keep making progress while we're supporting those who need us. And so that it's a really positive way of doing things. We've found to be able to just meet with those that need it and allow the others to keep doing their thing. So, and then the playlist looked different also for 7th and 8th grade.
We have two different styles. Both of them are designed as a game board. So we'll show you each of the different styles. But before I do that, I just wanted to point out, we also have an example for supply and demand, because once students have worked their way through all of the government playlists, then they move on to just basic economic skills. So that's another area that students work on during our workshop time once they have mastered the government skills. So let's look at types of government first.
Yeah. So you'll notice right away, the look is very different. This is a single page playlist rather than it being a long slideshow-based playlist. With this one, you are moving around what looks kind of like a traditional game board, like you'd have for a board game. And you're starting in the top left-hand corner. And every single one of our playlists for seventh and eighth grade starts with a video. We just feel like that's a good entry point for kids to be able to listen, to see a visual that goes along with the concept before we're asking them to dig into the reading and application skills. And then they continue around the game board clockwise. So you'd move from the watch activity to reflect, taking some time to think about what did I just see and hear in the video and kind of process that information a little bit. After they've done that, they move on to a reading activity, lays out some basic information about, in this case, types of government, different types of government. And then they have a couple of different chances to think about what they read, think about what they saw in the video, and then apply that to activities along the way. For any of these things, they're just clicking on the icon, and the icon is linked out to whatever it is that they're going to be doing. So it makes it really simple in terms of navigation. For the most part, you can see Andrea is doing that right now. She clicked on the Think and Apply activity there, and it comes up with a worksheet that we created in Google Docs. Little trick is to make those worksheets automatically create a copy or automatically prompt students to create a copy so that that way they're able to fill in the information in the worksheet that we created. And then once they've made it through the kind of required parts of the playlist, then they, like fifth and sixth grade you saw, have a choice board option. So they've kind of got the preliminary instruction that we wanted them to get and some practice, and now they can go off and pick how they'd like to continue practicing, or they can choose to go directly to their badge test if they feel like they really understand the information and they're ready to show their that they've mastered this particular concept. So down at the bottom, we have a couple of digital activities with quizzes and Quizlet. A lot of them are focused on vocabulary, building vocabulary about whatever the concept is that they're learning about. And then we also had a non-digital matching game that they could do if they wanted a break from the screen time. And then they go onto the badge test. With seventh and eighth grade, like we mentioned earlier, it's basically a chance to show that you've mastered the information. And if you are not quite there yet, you just start back around the game board again and revisit some of those activities, go back to that reading activity and make sure that you really looked closely at that, or rewatch the video to make sure that you remember what you heard and saw there. So it's just a kind of a cyclical process. And again, we have the opportunity to check in with students if they are struggling a little bit more so that we can help to reinforce some of the information.
And we also, as a built-in support, any on all of our game boards, any activity that asks students to read, there's also an accompanying audio that students can listen to and read along with.
Yeah, I think that's a really critical thing. I'm glad you mentioned that, because none of this is meant to be a reading assessment. This is all meant to be an assessment of just understanding the concepts. And ultimately, when it comes right down to it, it's as much an assessment of students being able to direct their own learning as it is any concept either. And so we really try to, for fifth and sixth grade and seventh and eighth grade, plan these playlists for content that's not absolutely essential for students to know. In this case, with the government stuff, it's things that we're going to revisit during other parts of our instruction at some other point in the year. And so if they don't get it here, then they'll have a chance to get it in another setting later on. And if they do get it here, then it gives them a good foundation for coming into those conversations later in the year. With fifth and sixth grade, if they know the geography, it could very very much come in handy with other things that they're doing. But if they don't get every piece of it because they're moving at a slower pace, it's not something that's gonna create a real deficit for them later on. So it's much more about perseverance and self-direction.
Yeah. And then again, like Kyle said, when they're ready, students take the badge test. If they do not pass the badge test, if they've not been able to demonstrate mastery, like Kyle said, they just will go back and revisit some activities, keep practicing until they feel comfortable, take it again. This is an example of one of our digital badges. Students will get a copy of that to put in their portfolio, and then they'll move on to the next one. So we had one other game board style that we wanted to show you for 7 and 8.
And this one looks more like the 5th and 6th grade playlist because it's built in Google Slides as opposed to on a Google Doc like the previous one we looked at. And the reason that we did it differently for this one is because there are so many different components that we wanted to include that it just didn't work. It wouldn't have fit in that other style. And so with this one, we just give them some quick introductory directions at the beginning. We have sort of a key of what all the different icons are going to mean that they'll encounter throughout the course of the playlist, just so that they know what they're looking for. Their most important one is probably the check, to let them know that that's a check-in spot where they have to make a decision. Do I feel comfortable with what I've learned so far, or should I go back and revisit some activities before I move on to the next part? Because this is branches of government, it's sort of broken into three chunks, one for each of the three branches. So starting with the executive, then moving to the legislative, and finally the judicial at the end. So we can take a look at that. So you notice you start in the top left-hand corner again, but this time instead of it moving around in kind of a cyclical nature, it winds its way through a process. And so again, we still start with a video as a good entry point for all students. Then there's a reading activity, then there's a second video to kind of reinforce what they read. And then there are two opportunities for them to play games that will allow them to apply their learning to situations. If you're not familiar with iCivics and you teach anything about government, you need to get familiar with iCivics because they are just an incredible resource. And they're adding even more new and really useful tools to their website all the time. So there's a couple of iCivics games there that allow students to kind of get a feel for what is the executive branch all about, and what's the role of the presidency, and how does that interact with other parts of the government. And so there's a couple of games they can play. They tend to get really engaged in those games. Sometimes they need a little nudge to keep moving past those games because they get kind of competitive and want to do the best that they can. And so you might have to keep an eye on that. But otherwise, they would move to the check mark. And the check mark would just be a chance for them to think, okay, so am I solid on this? Do I feel pretty good about this? If so, I'll move on. If not, I might go back and revisit the videos or the reading or something like that. The next chunk of space there is the next branch. And you'll see, again, there's a reading, there's a video, a couple of games that they can use to reinforce their learning. Moving on to the next section, starts with a reading prompt, and then they will click on the what's next link. And that's where they'll have a choice. They can go to a page that will allow them to learn a little bit more about the judicial branch, which is their kind of the third chunk of this playlist. They can go to a page that will give them some review activities of all the branches, so kind of putting all the information they've learned together and reviewing it there. Or they can say, I think I got this. I'm ready for my badge test. I want to challenge myself and see if I really mastered this content. Do you want to take a look at the judicial branch just so we can see what that looks like? So it's just kind of an extension, a final leg of what we saw before. So they've got a video, a puzzle that they can work on, and then a game where they can apply what they've learned. They would then click on what's next. And here we unfortunately ran into some problems with the pandemic. And so we did not end up putting any non-digital activities in here because it was a kind of an influx time, not knowing if students were going to be in the building or not in the building. And Would they have access to the non-digital activities if they're at home? And so we decided to just stick with the digital activities for now, but we'll put those in for future years so that there's an option between digital and non-digital practice about the three branches. And from there, it would give them the option to go back and decide, are they ready to move on or are they going to take their batch test and try to demonstrate mastery? So still the same basic process, same basic foundational thing that they're working their way through. It's just, it looks a little bit different because of the nature of the content we're going over.
So those playlists that we've talked about so far are ones that students work on every day. They work at their own pace. And just make progress. Once you finish this playlist, demonstrate mastery, you move on to the next one. And the last few examples we want to show you are lesson-based playlists. They're ones that we would only do for a specific amount of time because they're focused on one particular content area that we're working on in a particular unit. So as we said earlier, we use the term playlist pretty loosely. And so we've broken up these ones into different types of playlists. The first ones are a little bit more like choice boards or choice menus. This one is more of a traditional playlist if you're going to complete these tasks in this order. And the bottom ones are examples of hyperdocs that we have used. So we're going to show you each of those. Kyle, do you want to talk about the first one?
Sure. The first one as a choice menu or choice board style playlist is basically just asking students to make a choice up front of what they would like to learn about, and then giving them some options of how can you learn about whatever you've chosen in a variety of ways with a little bit of structure, but also allowing them to make some choices for themselves along the way. So for this particular choice board or playlist, we were learning about how did the 13th Amendment allow for certain activities or certain loopholes in the law to still oppress and persecute people of color, even with the abolition of slavery. And so the three topics that we limited it to were mandatory minimum sentences, racial profiling, and mass incarceration. And under each one of those, you can see that we've sort of connected that to a historical issue. And then the one on top would be the more modern issue that's associated with it. There's a quick introduction just to let them know kind of what these things are going to be about. And based on that introduction, they would make their choice. Which of these three things do I want to focus on? The mandatory minimums, racial profiling, or mass incarceration? And then our structured piece of this, the part that was our determination, was that you need to explore at least one resource from each of the three categories below your topic. So at least one article you have to look at least one video you need to watch, and at least one infographic you need to examine. And as they're doing that, they're gathering information of like, what did I learn about this particular topic? So the choice part that's involved is picking which topic is most interesting to you. There's also choice within most of the categories of which article do you want to read, which video do you want to watch, which infographic do you want to focus on. If you want to do more than that, you're more than welcome to. For students that were able to do it more quickly, we would challenge them. That would be sort of the extension activity of pick another one, go back and push yourself a little bit further. But then that that would end at a certain time, and what students were able to gather is what they were able to gather. And then we would move forward from there with this style of playlist.
And this was one of our most successful playlists. And I think that the reason for that is not only did it give students choice in topic, and give them some choice in the resources they're looking at, but we made sure to include articles, videos, and infographics because they allow students to access this information in different ways. So if you're someone who feels really comfortable with this topic, it's something that maybe you have some background knowledge on, or maybe you're someone who's a really strong reader, you might want to jump right into the article. if you're someone who needs to see things first, needs to hear things first, maybe you start with a video and that's your way into this information. For those that are more visual or maybe are not as confident in their reading skills, starting with the infographic was a good way so that everybody could kind of find their way into these really challenging topics in a way that worked best for them. So next one we'll look at is the core groups playlist. So this is one that's more of a traditional playlist of you do this task and then this task and then this task. This was one we used on the first day of school one time. We had sometimes in our class we use what we call core groups, which are groups of three or four students. And so anytime we need to work in a small group, that's your group. You know who you're going to go connect with. You're able to start building some relationships in those groups. And so this was for the first day of school to kind of get those groups together, establish those groups, and help them get to know one another within their groups. So again, we use icons. These icons are to show how the activity is to be completed. Sometimes it's something the whole group will do together. Sometimes it's something each person in the group needs to do separately. And sometimes it was just an activity that one person could do for the group. And so it just worked through some different tasks and with name your group, that's something the whole group would do together. And here's some directions for how they do that. And then they would just work their way down the list until they got to the end. And so that's more of a traditional playlist.
No, I was just gonna say, I think that shows, you know, even when there's something that's very kind of structured and step-by-step as a process, the value of visuals and having those icons still built in there of just to make it more engaging for students. If it was just a list of tasks and it was nothing but text, you know, even for adults, that can be pretty overwhelming, but just seeing it broken down in this table form, step by step, and feeling like, okay, I can come to, I can finish a step and I feel like I'm done and I can almost check that off the list and then move on to the next thing, I think is really helpful for students. And the icons really help to remind them of what the expectations are at each step of the process.
And then finally, we've done some experimenting in the last few years with HyperDocs. And so we're going to show you two versions of those. Do you want to do the first one and I'll do the second one?
Sure. So HyperDoc is a little bit different. It almost looks like the playlist that we use with fifth and sixth grade for independent workshops. But the difference is that the HyperDocs have resources for learning that students engage with, and then they complete activities right within the same space. And so just like any other lesson that you would do, generally the first step is find out what do students already know. Try to find out where they are coming into this.
That we always start with like, here's what we're doing and why. This one we actually left as an activity when we were out. We left this with a sub. So just starts with here's why we're doing this. Here's what we expect from you. And then it jumps in with here's the first task. Sorry to interrupt you.
Yeah, no problem. Because that's really important for students to always know the why. And so here they were just sort of gathering some really simple, straightforward, basic information, start with something simple, hopefully boost a little bit of confidence and get them started on a positive note as they are moving towards more challenging or complex ideas later in the HyperDoc. So here we've given a link over on the left-hand side. It's a really straightforward website with information laid out that will help them to answer a few basic questions about World War I, which they're gonna need kind of moving forward to set some context. And so they complete that activity and then they move on to the next activity. Again, a resource linked on the left-hand side at the top where it says click here, and looking over some information about who were the two competing sides in World War I so that they could start to get some context on who was involved and who were allies, who were opponents in this conflict. And so then the activity that they do with that is to click and drag the names of different countries below to the group that they belong to during the World War I era. And so they would complete that activity, and it continues throughout the hyperdock with different types of exploring of resources and different activities that are built right into each of the slides, so that they are slowly building information about all the different content that we want them to be exposed to and that they're going to use moving forward.
And each activity starts with a verb. So it might be explore, it might be explain, it might be apply, but each one tells them exactly what they need to be doing in that section.
Yep. This was one where the beginning part of the hyperdoc, I think, went pretty well, even without us there to support students. As they got into the more complex parts, we definitely noticed some trends in misunderstandings. And so that gave us a really great formative place to gather data and say, okay, here's what we need to go back and try to present in a different way, because the vast majority of students weren't understanding this particular part.
And if I remember correctly, when we used this one, most students got to, we generally stopped around these two slides. And so we were able to look at people's progress and think about, okay, if most people are ending here, how did they do so far? What are some of those misconceptions that we can go back and talk about as a full group to kind of build that knowledge together? And those that didn't get that far, why not? Was it that they were just taking their time? Was it that they were struggling in a certain area? And so that too is good information about how quickly or how slowly someone works through this. And so after we did that kind of check-in, filled in some information, we were able to have students continue to move forward, and we continued to kind of use that as check-in of where should we be, what do we need to support kids with as they're moving forward. And then finally, this last hyperdoc is one we made for our fifth and sixth graders about the elements of a story. So it starts with a video. I think we mentioned before, we like always start with a video when we can. It's just an easy way in for our students. They don't have to worry about their reading skills. They can just listen, watch, get information. So they watched a video about the basic elements of a story, and then we started breaking them down. And these ones don't have icons, but they're color coded. So all of the information about characters was on blue slides. There was a video on the left, activity for them to complete on the right. This one, we applied what they had just learned in the previous slide to a picture book we had read together earlier. And we linked the audio and to the book here in case they wanted to go back and explore, and again, a task. And so they just worked their way through that. Again, they're color coded. So setting was green. There are some different activities for setting, got into conflict, plot, and then they could put that all together. They watched a video, just a short video of someone telling a story, and then they had to apply what they had learned so far by finding those different elements in that story. So those are just some of the different styles of playlists that we use. They definitely take some time to build for sure, but once you have a template, it's really easy to just substitute the information. So like the geography playlist, I spent last summer building that template and kind of testing it out, figuring out what works, what doesn't work. And so that was my summer. But once I had that one template, then we could quickly just put all the other geography ones together, just change out the links to different resources. And it lasted us for quite a while to get through the year. So there is some legwork that you have to put in up front. But I think it pays off in the long run of just having multiple days, sometimes multiple weeks worth of lessons and activities ready to go.
I think one thing that a trap that we fell into that we've since kind of figured out a way out of is don't be afraid to reuse the same resources over and over again. So for like geography, the Lizard Point website is our kind of hub of where they go to do their pre-assessment and where they go to do their badge test. And once they get familiar with that, then they're comfortable with it. It's sort of a way for them to maybe not I think it's a more accurate way to assess their skills, because it's not the medium that's getting in the way, because they've had plenty of practice with that and they're really able to work with it well. Same thing with the government playlists for 7-8, the fact that we use so much from iCivics, I think is really helpful. So you shouldn't shy away from reusing the same types of resources over and over again. We fell into that trap, I think, of, oh, we have to have all these different things or else they're going to get sick of things or bored with things. And I don't think that's the case at all. It definitely helps to ask them to do different skills and apply their knowledge in different ways. But I recommend finding good, solid resources and really utilizing them as much as you can.
One of the things young people need practice with is executive functioning. And teachers will often say, rightly so, but they're really bad at this. They make bad choices. Right. And, you know, sometimes it's a sequence of making bad choices and getting support on how to get better at it. It's in that muck and mire that executive functioning gets better. It's not that everybody comes out of the gate, oh, great, I have choices. I'm now going to make good ones. It is messy, especially at first. But I've certainly found the executive functioning and growth, sometimes the payoff is afterwards. It's not always right there and then within that menu. So for what it's worth.
Yeah, our first year doing this, like Kyle said, we went too far too fast, and we overestimated the skills that our students were coming to us with. And so our fifth graders were like, here's a playlist, go choose how you want to learn this. And they're like, what do you want me to do? Tell me what to do. I don't understand. I'm supposed to sit here, you're supposed to teach me. So it's been a lot of trial and error, and we're still tweaking things as go.
Can I ask a question about your lesson playlists? When you have like options under video, under reading, and one other thing, are the kids getting to choose? What are the instructions about where they're getting their content? Are they supposed to be, you know, maybe watching a video and doing a reading, and then how does that work?
I think you're referring to the Faults of the 13th Amendment playlist.
Yes, yes.
In that one, yeah, there was links to videos, articles, and infographics, and we asked them to choose at least one resource in each of those categories.
Okay.
And the reason for that was that we wanted to provide a variety of resources and access points. So if somebody was a really strong reader, you can really dig into it here. If reading isn't really a strength for you, you can still get the same information through listening and watching this video. And so just making sure that every student would be able to take something away, but also having some kids kind of pushing them beyond their comfort zone. If you always watch these videos, why don't you try this infographic? What can you take away from this?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I think a lot of it comes down to being really intentional about what am I actually wanting from my students in this particular moment. And if it's developing content understanding, then I don't want to give them a reading test, right? So if we can give them different ways to access the information, maybe that's, you know, the video and the infographic are the catalyst for, okay, now I feel confident going into this reading piece that I probably wouldn't have in the first place. And so much of what we do with the playlist is not assessing like reading skills, writing skills, as much as it is, you know, the self-direction skills, the ability to persevere, and then building content knowledge that formatively that they can utilize and apply later. And then that's where the assessment piece comes in. I just want to reiterate that what you're seeing is a variety of tools that we've created, and by created, I mean probably kind of stole from somebody and adapted for our own purposes. None of this is solely our creation. And we, you know, it's just fair warning and transparency that everything that we've got, we've sort of taken pieces from other folks and used them as inspiration. We also want to just reiterate that all of these tools, no matter what you're looking at there, are really designed for a couple of different purposes: to provide choice in how students learn, what students learn, and the pace at which students learn.
Feel free to make copies, feel free to make them your own. Definitely, we are very willing to share in that that work that needs to go in the front. Feel free to use any of our templates, whatever you need.
And if you come up with something really amazing using those templates, send it our way, because we would love to see it and probably use it too.